Jim, it is interesting that a document that was supposed to end a discussion has done nothing but begin one. Allison?
Started a whole new one. That's right.
All right, Chris, thanks so much. Let's bring in now Colonel Stephen Kleinman. He's a former senior intelligence officer at the Air Force. He has researched interrogation for decades and appears in a campaign for Human Rights First. That's an advocacy group highlighting human rights failures in the U.S. government and private companies. Colonel Kleinman, great to see you this morning.
Thank you very much for having me.
As you know, there is a huge debate in this country this morning about whether or not the so-called enhanced interrogation tactics actually did work on getting actionable information out of these detainees, or whether or not they actually clammed up as a result of what some people call torture. Where do you fall on this?
Well, I think, first of all, the report clearly lays out the systematic use of torture by any standard. And then the question we have to ask ourselves, beyond the moral dilemma, which I think we should all be struggling with, and beyond the legal argument, which I don't really have standing to engage on, is whether or not it's operationally effective. Is it a reliable means of collecting useful information, accurate, timely, and comprehensive? And I think the body of behavioral science literature that would relate to, for example, cognitive functions would suggest no. I mean, an interrogator's primary goal is to win the access to somebody's virtual memory. I mean, all the information we want resides in human memory, and that's very fragile.
And Colonel Kleinman, you have studied this for decades, and the alternatives that you suggest, that you say work better than any sort of brutality or enhanced interrogation methods, are fascinating. I just want to run through some of these that you say work much better. We've put together a list. Number one, you say give a gift. You think you could give a gift to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and he would open up and tell you information?
Well, let me phrase it in proper terms. Giving a gift is just an example of reciprocity. There's an adaptive and learned behavior that goes back to our evolutionary legacy. It's just when we receive something of any value, there's a very, very deeply driven need, requirement to give something back. And it happens over and over again in all sorts of settings. And certainly it's demonstrated itself in the interrogation setting as well. And I don't mean to belittle or certainly to simplify it to say you give a gift and Khalid Sheikh Mohammed will provide the answers that we're seeking. But it's a way of reaching out and creating a bridge.
It was fascinating because you say that it's just in our DNA. If you provide one of these detainees, you've seen evidence, if you give them a cup of tea, if you give them a blanket, if they're cold, suddenly they feel obligated to give you something. Is that what you mean by build a bridge?
Yeah, exactly. It's part of a developing a relationship beyond rapport. I mean, there could be a situation where the detainee literally hates the interrogator, hates being there, but they make a rational calculus that answering questions is more in their interest than not. And not because they're threatened, but because of the way the opportunities are presented. And reciprocity, I mean, there's six fundamental principles of persuasion based on Dr. Robert Cialdini's work, which drives the multi-billion dollar advertising industry. And to say that it's not applicable in the interrogation room is inconsistent with the behavioral science research that we've done, certainly in the last 10 years.
And another thing that you recommend that you say is highly effective is use scarcity on them. What does that mean?
Absolutely. When anything is seen as viewed as in limited quantity, we place greater value on it, whether it's water during a drought or food during a famine. And opportunities to gain something by providing information can present it in a way that's very limited. For instance, we're talking to three people, and the first person that is helpful to us will receive something, you know, a release, better treatment, moving to out of the detention facility into some other facility. So you can present it that way. I mean, you can construct it in a way that becomes very, very appealing.
One of the most fascinating that you write about being an effective tactic is, and it flies in the face of everything that the enhanced interrogation techniques stand for, it's avoid humiliation. How does avoiding humiliation work better than using humiliation?
Well, if you think about the evolution, if you will, of extremism, and I took part in a multinational, multi-year study looking at precisely that. Motivate somebody to choose the path of extremism. And you look at Lawrence Wright's book, Looming Tower, you look at the self-reports of thousands of young extremists, and humiliation is at the bottom. The lack of opportunity, the lack of to get a job, to marry, to have social position, to move forward. An extremist group comes along, gives them an opportunity to be part of something much larger than themselves. So humiliation was what drove them. So if humiliation was a key factor in their extremist development, why would we think that humiliation would then in turn cause them to cooperate with somebody that they see as the enemy? So the Army field manual technique known as Pride and Ego Down is a perfect example of a unsubstantiated approach that is probably counterproductive.
And in fact, we know from the Senate report that Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, at least according to the report, that once he was stripped and waterboarded and shaved, he clammed up and stopped cooperating. That's what the Senate report says. Colonel Steve Kleinman, you've given us a lot of food for thought this morning. Thanks so much for coming on New Day.
Thank you for having me and covering this important topic.
Thank you.